very, very appropriate. For this, the third Sunday in the season of Easter. This is April the 26th. And probably the only Sunday during April that's been good weather. But the Sunday's not over yet. But we hope and pray that it will be good. We need to pray now a prayer. This is a collect for the third Sunday in Easter time. And I want you to listen to how appropriate this this prayer is for today. It's several hundred years old, and it's from the Book of Common Prayer, but it's as relevant as anything that's going on today. Let us pray. Tell us, O God, the mystery of your plans for the world, and show us the power of your risen Lord, so that day by day, obeying you, we may look forward to a feast with you within your promised kingdom. By the very grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, and the sweet Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. We want you to, by way of announcements, again, we appreciate all that make this service possible. And these that are participating in the service, thank you ever so much. Our staff, they're very, very wonderful and beautiful, and we appreciate all that they do. We want you to keep the bells ringing. Every evening at around 6 o'clock, these are for our first responders and folks that are on the front lines for us during the coronavirus. I mean, if you can't ring a bell, or even if we've stopped ringing bells as a state at this time on the calendar, the governor only asked us to do it for several weeks. But you keep praying, and you keep being in prayer for these people that are working for us so diligently and faithfully. We want to thank you for your support of the church, your prayerful support, your offerings, your gifts, your services. Again, we thank you ever so much for your efforts and what you do to make the church still function and be a part of your life and the life of this community. Last weekend, we had our food pantry. It was quite successful, and we appreciate all those individuals that participated in the food pantry and delivered those meals, and the people that received the meals. The boxes were so thankful, so very thankful. So remember those individuals, the ones that received the boxes, and those who also prepare and make them available and ready. We want you to keep safe. Be safe, stay at home, and practice safe distancing, or all of those things that we need to be doing now to remain safe. I'm asked continually when we will be meeting publicly again for worship. Well, every day, hopefully we're making progress in this area. So maybe next Sunday, the first Sunday of May, we can tell you something about the future. We hope. And I'm sure when we do start back, the way we worship publicly will maybe be a little bit modified from usual, but we have a very large sanctuary. There's room for everyone, we hope. So just keep that in mind as we plan for the future. And we know the future is in God's hands, and I know we're in God's hands, so therefore we're in his future. This time we want to affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Some are going for tests, some are starting treatments, different things are going on in different lives. Please remember these individuals in your prayers. Now, our scripture today is from the 24th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. It's a continuation. It's as though the Easter story is lectionary scripture for today. And the topic is after April showers come May flowers. And did a little research to find out the origin of that term. It's an English term, came into existence in the late 1800s, and it was just came out of actually Britain. And the term is so appropriate for kind of what we would like to say today. This is the Walk to Emmaus scripture from the 24th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And it's a lectionary scripture for today, and it seems to be very, very appropriate. So hear the word of God that's always appropriate. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. and talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you're walking alone?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name is Cleophas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place here in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" And they replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and the elders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified. But we had hoped." Now, as we read that scripture, I would like for you to keep in mind that this is post-resurrection day, and they know about the resurrection. Mary's already conveyed this message to them early in the morning, and they're on the road to Emmaus. Notice, as we read this, it seems to me like Thomas is not the only one that does some doubting here. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some of the women in our group astonished us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that we had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb. That would have been Peter and John, according to John's gospel, went to the tomb as the woman had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, this is Jesus talking to these two. "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared." And now he goes into a message. He preaches to them about the Old Testament and the prophecy and the expectation of the Messiah. "Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and that they enter into glory, his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself and all the scriptures. And as they came near the village to which they were going, he walked on ahead of them, and as if he was going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now near over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread, and he blessed and broke it. Now, this is the first time in the era of the resurrection, post-resurrection days, that Jesus ever celebrates the Eucharist, the Lord's Supper, with any of the disciples. We would like to say it was the Thursday night before the crucifixion, and it was. He institutes a new sacrament with his blood and his body. But this is the first time after the resurrection he shares communion. He blessed the bread and he broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were open, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. And they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God, and thanks be to God. Well, the topic of our message has to do with April showers bringing May flowers. This is the sixth Sunday we've gone through this kind of worship in our church. And it reminds me of how difficult this April has been for us. I'm also reminded how much worse it could have been or could be. It's been a very difficult month in many ways. As we said earlier, it's probably the only Sunday of the month that it's not stormed. Or we've not had tornadoes like we did even on Easter Sunday 2 weeks ago when about a dozen people in southern Mississippi was killed because of a violent storm. This April is definitely, it's one of the most unusual Easters we've ever had, with all of the flus and viruses and problems that we're having to contend with today in our culture. Well, if you can relate to this, and we all can relate to it because we're all there, then we might understand kind of how the disciples felt on the weekend of Easter. How they felt immediately following the crucifixion. Lost and abandoned. How they felt right up maybe to the resurrection and even after the resurrection. Notice the question marks and the doubts on these two individuals' minds as they're walking on the road to Emmaus. If you can relate to them, then we may understand. Or if you can relate to the situation we're facing this month, maybe you can understand how they felt that day. One of the most quoted verses of scriptures in the Bible is Proverbs 29:18. And it fits so well. And you're very familiar with this passage. It says, "Where there is no vision, the people perish." So we're in the midst of April. We have a vision for May, don't we? Hopefully it'll be a little better in so many ways. And if that passage is true, and you believe it's true, where there is no vision, people perish, then also the parallel would be true as well. Where there is vision, people live. Where there's vision, where we prepare, where we plan, people prosper. And Les Miserables, there's a line that says, "There's grief that can't be even spoken of." Some people understand that. Some people understand it better than others. Some people have told me, even through this era, through this time of depression that they've gone through this month, that they're having a hard time even praying and worshiping. But I assure them that God understands. That He understands even the groanings of their heart, according to the Apostle Paul. There is a grief that only the Lord can understand. Mary Magdalene came to the tomb on that first day of the week, not for the resurrection, but she came to the tomb, actually, according to Luke's gospel, just to complete the burial process. Because her Lord was dead. And as we said on Easter Sunday, that's the wonderful paradox of the story. She came and was standing by the tomb of a dead person. Don't take that away from the scripture. That's very important, because without the life, death, and there would not be the resurrection. These two disciples are on the road to Emmaus. Notice in verse 21 how they had hoped He was the one to redeem Israel. Now Luke makes a point that they say this with a real somber, sad face. Luke tells us, and he makes that point. They had hoped. Now, if anyone could have had hope, it would have been that group. Now, these two individuals were probably not the 12, or the 11 as it was at this time. This is part of the 70, most likely, group of disciples that are sent out. But boy, they had a reason to be optimistic. Just a week earlier, Jesus makes his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And oh, they were there. All the people of Jerusalem was there. And it was a wonderful time of children raising palm branches and laying their coats down before Jesus as he rides into Jerusalem to fulfill all of the expectation of the Messiah. I love the lines of Jesus Christ Superstar. When this happens in the rock opera, when this event happens, the scribes and Pharisees are watching this and they're bemoaning the fact that Jesus is coming in and so popular in Jerusalem, and they're speaking negative things. And Jesus says, "Why waste your breath moaning at the crowd? Nothing can be done to stop their shouting. If every tongue would cease, the noise would still continue. The rocks and stones themselves would start to sing, Hosanna, Hosanna, Zanna, Zanna, Ho. Zanna, Ho, Zanna, Ho, Superstar." They had a cause to celebrate. Now notice, here we are, and this is the Easter Sunday for this text. They had already had Mary tell them about the risen Savior, but they have no hope. They had hope, but now their hope was dead because they believed that their hope died with Christ. And one of the great fears that they had at this time, and why they had no hope, is really because they were realists, and they most likely concluded that there could easily be more crosses on Golgotha Hill, and they could be the ones nailed to those crosses. So they were very fearful. But it doesn't end here. Easter that day continues, and it ends with Mary testifying to the disciples, "I've seen the Lord." We read this so beautiful. It's such a beautiful passage in the Gospel of John. And then we read this passage from the Gospel of Luke about the disciples walking on the road to Emmaus, and the Lord opens their eyes as they read the Scripture. Easter is about new life. New life. It's literally about a New Testament. A New Testament. Easter is the very positive answer to the Old Testament question, to Job's question in the Old Testament. Easter is the answer to it. Job's question was, if a person dies, can he live again? Job asked that question. And Easter is the answer to that question, the New Testament answer. Easter is the answer to the problem of death itself. Here's a statement. I don't know if it's original with me, but I'll take credit for it. Death becomes an event that's lived through because of Easter. Easter reinforces the wisdom of Solomon, or the Song of Solomon. It goes like this: "The soul of the just are in God's hand, and torment shall not touch them. They are at peace." Isn't that wonderful? What would we say to some of the theologians, the naysayers that say there's a very little concept of torment or hell in the Old Testament? Well, listen to the Song of Solomon. It speaks of it. "The souls of the just are in God's hands, and torment shall not touch them. They're at peace." They found that out. Mary, those disciples. They started Easter out in very, well, actually it was very high spirits if you want to count the Thursday night experiencing the Passover with the disciples. That Thursday night, Jesus gathered. It's the Passover is the high holy moment for the Hebrew children. Represents so much, and it's so significant. And Jesus was celebrating that meal with his disciples. It's called the Seder meal. And he was celebrating it with them. And to teach this in my confirmation class, you see this card right here? It's a postcard. I usually show them this postcard. I just love it. It's just a little charcoal drawing of a door. Simple postcard. And around the door on the three corners, the sides and the top, is some red marks. Just a simple door with red marks. In confirmation class, we talk about the Passover. We talk about the children of Israel being in bondage and in captivity down in Egypt. And they got there because of Joseph being sold into slavery, and how they multiplied and grew, and how they became such a war force for the Egyptians. And then finally through Moses, the great liberator, the great one to lead them out. The book of Exodus tells us. Exodus. After a season was a high, holy, wonderful time for the children of Israel. And that's what they were celebrating that Thursday night, the wonderful Seder meal. And as they were celebrating this meal, Jesus took the bread and the wine, part of the meal. In the King James Version, I love it. It said he sopped it. He took the bread and put it into the wine and sopped it and took it. And as he was doing this, he institutes an entirely new Passover that the children of Israel that the Christian faith will adopt. And it's called the Eucharist, or the Holy Communion. And this is actually the great transition between the Old Testament and the New Testament, the very difference between Passover and Easter. That's why they're both the same time of the year. This is why this was a good, optimistic time for the disciples. Notice in this little card, right in the middle of the door, is a shadow of a cross. And on the cross would be blood, red mark also. The point is with that, and that's why I use it in confirmation class, we walk through the Old Testament, tell them in the importance of the door, blood on the doorpost, blood of innocent lamb, and then we talk in parallel about the blood on the cross, shed of the ultimate innocent lamb, Christ. Now they were celebrating this very high holy event on the Thursday night before the crucifixion. And there would be no reason to be in low spirits. But they, as the week in progressed, they were in repeated low spirits, repeatedly. Their hope was shattered when Jesus dies on the cross. So no wonder, even though Mary had conveyed to them at this point that the Lord is risen, they obviously something's not sinking in. And they had hoped. Notice the verse 21. But those who have no hope when Jesus died received new hope on Easter and the days that followed Easter. For Mary, her new hope was when Jesus says, "Mary," at the tomb. And she recognizes him. For these disciples, it was when they were walking to Emmaus. And he breaks bread with them, and they receive the sacrament for the first time, and they recognize the Lord. This is their high holy moment of hope. They know their Redeemer lives, and their hope is restored. I hope somehow, some way, we know right now during April that the coronavirus is not going to defeat us. There is hope. New hope around the corner. May is coming. You know, and I love April. Before we dismiss April, I'm not through with it yet. My anniversary is this month. I love it. It's a great time of the year. It's a good month. But April showers bring May flowers. There's better news around the corner. Hope is a very fragile thing. And evil can destroy it. Whether it's evil people, or whether it's evil bacteria, or whether it's an evil virus. Evil can destroy hope. Whether it's hatred, bigotry, illegal drugs, If we give in to the forces of evil, whether it's human beings or whether it's a virus, we give in to the forces of evil, then wrong will triumph. And we don't believe in that. We believe that after April comes May. But there's another way. Christ's people standing against evil for hope and always for hope. Elie Wiesel was a Jewish historian, rabbi, writer, who lived through the Holocaust. And he was a great student of the Old Testament. And he said the book of Job, he felt that the book of Job was so pessimistic and so sad and depressing, he never wanted to read it. And it reminded him of how the Jews had been treated all of these centuries, reading the book of Job, until he read the New Testament. Now, that doesn't mean that he converted to Christianity. It simply means he read the New Testament. And as he read the New Testament, he put it over against the Old Testament. This is a Jewish rabbi we're talking about. And he said he came to believe something very special about the book of Job. That Job was not nearly as depressing as he thought. Job refused to let evil have the upper hand. That's what's wonderful and redemptive about that book that so many people do not enjoy or like or appreciate. He refused to let evil have the upper hand. He lost his health. He lost, like the people in southern Mississippi, Easter Sunday, we lost about a dozen people in death. Job lost 7 sons and 3 daughters in a storm. But Job refused to let the evil have the upper hand. And we, Christian folks, are to follow the example of Job. We're to do the same thing by rejecting the work of evil. Whether it's a virus or whether it's evil people, this is striking a blow for good. And we're always to do this. This is our job as Christians. As long as evil is resisted, then God's victory is sure. That's why we preach that April showers bring May flowers. There's a hope that was revealed to these pilgrims on the road to Emmaus. They turn around and they go back to Jerusalem to share their story. This week, I was watching, this is the last story we'll use this morning, I was watching the History Channel and it was talking about the presidents. And it was quoting many of the presidents of the past of this country and their great contributions made and how they were quoted. And they were quoting all of these presidents of yesteryear. But when it came to George Bush, Senior, George H. Bush, they couldn't say anything very positive. All they could do is quote the negative line, you know, read my lips, no, more taxes, and got him into trouble. And that's what he's remembered for. But one of these journalists said there's another story that we ought to be thinking about when we think of George Bush and some quotes. And this is the story. It's a really unique story. That when he was vice president, he was asked to go to Moscow at the death of Leonid Brezhnev. Brezhnev died and Gorbachev became the leader of the Soviet Union. And as the vice president, he goes and he represents this country at the funeral. And George Bush in his memoirs says that it was the most depressing funeral he had ever experienced in his life. It was nothing redemptive at all about it. There was no hymns, no scriptures, no prayers. These were literally godless communist people. And it was reflected, he said, in the funeral service. Until the very final act of the funeral. The very last thing that happened was the casket was closed and Brezhnev. And his wife goes up to the casket before it's closed to put a rose in with her husband. But she does something very remarkable. And Bush said he was standing within feet from her there on the front row, and he saw her do this. When she puts the rose down by her husband's body, she also reaches across him and makes the sign of the cross on his chest. Now, get the picture. Nothing Christian had been going on in this funeral at all. And Bush said she was making some kind of powerful statement here about herself, or maybe about her husband, or both. She was saying that maybe she was a closet Christian. Or maybe that Brezhnev may have even been a Christian. And in his memoirs, he says this about the event. He says, in this single act, God broke through the core of the communist system. Now that's a quote worth remembering. In this one single act. Now, what happened a few months later is that our president of the United States then was in Berlin, Germany. And he makes a statement to the then prime minister of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev. And he says, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. George Bush said it might have all started right there with Lenin Brezhnev's wife when she makes the sign of the cross over her husband's chest. In this one single act, God broke through the core of the communist system. What we're saying this morning, what we're saying through this wonderful scripture from the Gospel of Luke, is that God still breaks through. That's it. April will be over soon. All those Sunday storms we've had all month long. April will be over soon, and May is around the corner. Does that mean May is going to be better? We don't know. I'm not a prophet. I can't tell the future. But we have hopes that God still breaks through. Like those disciples walking on the road to Emmaus, we had hoped. Yes, indeed. They had hope. They had hope. And their hope was turned into a new hope. What a good name for a church. New hope. Those who had no hope walking along the road after breaking bread with Christ and receiving the sacrament have new hope. So in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as we're approaching, this is the last Sunday of this month. We're going into another month. May we have new hope. We believe in the resurrection. We're people of the Easter faith. We believe after the April showers come May flowers, and that things will be better. So we dedicate ourselves to that truth and that fact, believing it will happen. Those who have no hope can have hope. Let's have our closing and invitational hymn, and may God have a blessed way.
To make all my world. chapter.
If we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Gracious God, we ask your immense, marvelous blessings upon us as we worship. We pray your immense blessings upon all of the worshipers, all of these individuals that have participated in this service of worship. We dedicate this service of worship unto you, gracious God. And we lift up your church here, there, and everywhere. The people that call themselves Christians, whether they're here or even in some other area of the corner of the world, we lift that universal church unto you, and we ask your immense, marvelous blessings upon them. Keep us safe, and in your name we pray and give thanks. Amen.